sit down. This is a
narrated slideshow. I do not have my electronic laser pointer, so I'm going to use the old school analog stick pointer to point things out in the pictures. So, as my introduction stated, I grew up here in Bath, and I've been living on Hermit Island now since 2005. And I grew up here in this town. I don't have any brothers or sisters. I grew up as an only child. I grew up reading a lot of books. I grew up in a historic house packed full of books. And as a child, I read a lot, and I've always been a history buff. And for me, I time traveled all throughout history and met lots of different people at different times and different places. And I guess I still do that now. And so my family's been involved with Hermit Island since 1950. My grandfather, Sumner Sewell, purchased Hermit Island. This right here is a picture of Small Point Harbor, looking south down the harbor from the location of the Lobster Pound on Hermit Island. So my grandfather, Sumner, bought the island in 1950 from the Morse family, who had held the island since about 1800. And prior to that, the McIntyre family. And prior to that, we get back into to Indian times. And so I spent my first 20-something summers growing up on this island, basically getting older, becoming a man, and surrounded by the beauty of Small Point and of Hermit Island, the ocean, trees, and everything. And I've always wondered, you know, who was here before? What was this place like? Who lived here? How did they live? And so since I moved back in 2005, I've been trying to put together that story of this particular place. It's kind of a micro history of a very specific place in time over the last several hundred years. So I look at the records, the little bits and pieces that we have left, these threads of our stories. And so I gather these threads that might be an archaeological site, it might be a deed, an old picture. And so I collect these things and trying to put them together into a coherent story of this one particular place over a couple hundred years. This is an aerial photograph, just to give you a good shot of Hermit Island. This was probably taken in the 1950s. It's after we had bought it, because the Lobster Pound had been constructed, but before it had really been developed into a campground, and gives you a good shot. This whole piece of land right here is Hermit Island. It's on the southern tip of Phippsburg. That's Bald Head, and this is Small Point right here, the very southern tip of Phippsburg. And then there's a beach there across, that's Head Beach, and the road across the beach is what leads out onto Hermit Island. So it's about a mile and a half long and about a half a mile wide, and basically forms the whole western side of Small Point Harbor. This is Small Point Harbor right in here. And this cove up at the northern end would become what's now, or was the Lobster Pound, the Small Point Lobster Pound. But that's a good aerial shot of the island we're going to be talking about. Another Coast Guard chart. Again, Hermit Island, Small Point Harbor, Casco Bay. And this gentleman, I guess this is perhaps where my story starts. This is my great-great-great-great-great-grandfather, Dummer Sewell. Dummer is the first one in my family. Dummer and his brother Henry came to what would later become Bath in 1760, early 1760s, from York, Maine. And that was the start of my family here in this particular town. I put him up there because in the course of my research of Hermit Island, which we've only owned since 1950, I've come across Dummer's signature because as Justice of the Peace, he presided over some of the inventories and date, title, and deed information that I've researched. And of course, Dummer School, named after him, and his house still stands on High Street. And my folks live in the house built by his grandson, William, who started the shipyard here in town. All right. better image, because this encompasses a large part of our story. Here's the whole southern end of Phippsburg. Over here, Popham, Fort Popham, Popham Beach, the site of the Popham Colony right here. Here's Herman Island right here, Small Point right here. Of course, it's Seawall Beach and Popham Beach. Between Small Point Harbor and Atkins Bay over here in Popham, there are two great tidal rivers and tremendous salt marshes. The Morses River right here, and basically all the tan that you see in this satellite image is salt marsh. So you have a tremendous set of salt marshes over here, which you drive through on the way out to Popham Beach, and the Morses River, a tidal river that courses through them, and then Spirit Pond, which is up there off of the Morses River, you drive by on the way to Popham. And then right here, this forested ridge, this is what we call Morses Mountain, the site of the first Morses settling there. And then right here is Sprague River, and again, another huge, huge salt marsh system. Now these salt marshes are important. They were important for the native people that lived there, and they were important for the first settlers. And so I wanted to give you an idea of where they were in relationship to Hermit Island itself and the harbor. What I'm going to talk about to begin with is the existence of a Native American canoe carry, basically a highway that led from the Kennebec River and Midcoast over here into Casco Bay, and it would allow people to travel. Now back then, before roads, your waterways were your highways. The Wabanaki people traveled in birch bark canoes, and in order to avoid this mouth of the river here, incredibly treacherous place for small vessels, a short carry, you paddle your canoe into Atkins Bay, a short carry here, where the Percy cottages are now, would bring you into Spirit Pond. Spirit Pond, you would follow out into the Morses River, follow the Morses River down towards the mouth of the Morses River. There's a low point in Morses Mountain in the ridgeline in a very narrow piece of land, which is actually where the first Morses set their farm up. A short carry across there would drop you in to the tidal rivers in the Sprague Marsh. The Sprague Marsh could bring you right over, and near the mouth of the Sprague River, another short carry drops you into Small Point Harbor. Therefore, you can get from all the interior waterways up the Kennebec River, would allow you access into the interior. You could follow internal waterways over to Penobscot Bay through the Sheepskit and through the various coastal islands. So that carry was a very important important travel route, basically the southernmost entry into Casco Bay. And that would be why later on the Prajepskit proprietors would be building a fort down here in order to guard that carry. So that's kind of an overview of the terrain. And we'll just keep moving on here. This map right here, this is a mouth of the Kennebec River where we were just looking at. This is a 1605 map that Samuel Champlain made. I wanted to show it to you. It doesn't show Hermit Island on it, but again, this is Atkins Bay. This is the mouth of the river, and you can see by where the cottages are now in Popham, there are several houses on this. Again, this is 1605. This is pre-Popham Colony. This indicates the presence of native habitations over at the mouth of the river over there in Popham. These would be Wabanaki, the people that we now call Wabanaki, people of the dawn. These were ancestors of those people, and they were living all about the river and waterways, the coast. This is another map that Champlain made. Again, this right here is the mouth of the river. The scale's a little wacky. Merrymeeting Bay is actually up here. This is probably up towards Nequasset here. But again, farther up the river, you see large Indian villages, and there's some small ones down there by Atkins Bay over at Cox's Head, where there's actually shell middens and stuff, which are probably related to the people living there for a long time. Now, people showed up right after the Ice Age, so we're talking people that have been there for thousands of years. This was the type of habitation folks were living in. This is actually a picture from the 30s from Nova Scotia. But that is a birch bark lodge. That's Mi'kmaq. The Mi'kmaq, The Passamaquoddy, the Maliseet, and the Penobscot are the four tribes of Wabanaki people that remain in the state today. Most of your Mi'kmaq people are found in Nova Scotia. Your Maliseet people are predominantly in New Brunswick, and Passamaquoddy and Penobscots still call Maine their home. Another shot from around the same time. This is 1930s up in Nova Scotia, but basically the same type of structures were being used by Indian people here in Maine in the 1600s. That's your transport. That's an illustration from the 1830s, but that's how people were getting around. This one, the later 1800s, Penobscot Bay, native people, Penobscot or Passamaquoddy. Again, just to give you an idea, because we don't have images from that far back. This right here is a fire pit that was dug up in the late 1800s in Popham by Charles Willoughby. Again, documenting that native presence there. Those little stones were most likely used to cook the food. Stones were heated up, dropped into either birch bark or pottery containers to boil your stew. That's a piece of native pottery dug up here on the Kennebec by Charles Willoughby. Again, around the turn of the century. Late 1800s, early 1900s. Okay, so the sturgeon. This is one of the connecting parts of our story with our Merry Meeting Bay. One of the neat things about Hermit Island is that we can still see the sturgeon jump all around Hermit Island. We still have a healthy population of sturgeon. And here in the Kennebec River and Merry Meeting Bay, the mouth of the Kennebec, my understanding is are the largest remaining populations of Atlantic sturgeon and short-nosed sturgeon, which are now on the endangered species list. These were fish that were important to Wabanaki people who hunted them by spear with torchlight from canoe. They're gigantic fish. They're prehistoric fish. They have a scaly, armored back. And the purpose of the nighttime fishing, the sturgeon would be attracted by a birch by the light from the birch bark torch. They would come to the surface to investigate the light. After satisfying themselves of the light, they would turn to go back down, revealing their stomach, and then they could be speared. And then that would result in basically an early version of a Nantucket sleigh ride, where the large fish would tow you around in your canoe until it tired enough that you could pull it ashore. These right here are some of the things that were dug up around Spirit Pond in Phippsburg in the early 70s related to the so-called Viking rune stones. There are numerous archaeological sites in that area, native archaeological sites that these were dug out of. It's the opinion of some people that this is clearly a native symbol and not a Viking symbol. Native people also had the four directions. It's also important to understand that the Indian people in this area were Christianized very early by the French. So already by the mid-1600s, Indian people on the Kennebec River were practicing some form of Catholicism. Quite often with native peoples would mix newfound religion with older ceremonies as well. But this is one of those relics from town that has been dug up. This right here, grinding stone that was found, found on Small Point Harbor near the Aliquippa, which is an old house down there. Don't know its present location, most likely. What's interesting is when the first Europeans showed up in this area and they spoke with the Indians, they were asking about corn being grown. And the tribes at the tribal people at the mouth of the river informed them that they had once grown corn there, but they no longer grew corn there because people from across the water came and took it from them. But if you went farther up the river, there were Indians growing corn farther up the river. Now, this particular grinding stone, I'm not sure in Small Point Harbor, really, if they were growing corn. There's not a lot of good agricultural land. However,
we have lots of red oak trees all around Small Point Harbor. And the acorns were a traditional food source that after boiling and processing with water could be made into flour and made quite edible. So I suspect that this grinding stone perhaps was used for acorns rather than corn per se. This is a picture from the top of Morses Mountain looking over the Sprague River. The Indian carry I spoke about would have come through right through the water there. This is from the top of the mountain looking eastwards over to Spirit Pond is right there, and that's Atkins Bay and the Kennebec River. This is the foundation probably to either Daniel Morse's house or barn right there on where I believe the carry went through over on Morse's Mountain. This is after you've walked over the mountain and come down and crossing the field with the house in it. That's looking from that same location across the marsh where the carry went through. And that's the farmstead that is on the site now. That's at Spirit Pond. That's an old mill dam there. Again, this would have been, that wouldn't have been there when the original carry was there. Codfish. Well, codfish is what brings us to the European side of the story. Codfish being the fish that built the Northeastern and New England fisheries. There were fishermen fishing. Now we know the Popham colonists were there, 1607, 1608. Well, within the decade after that, the Pophams were sending fishing expeditions along the coast of Maine. So already by the second decade of the 1600s, European people were active along the coast here. Undoubtedly some of them spending the whole winter. They would be here in the summer to fish for the codfish, but that was what the Northeastern fisheries was based on. Now, this is a picture of another old house that no longer stands down there. I show it to you because of this hill right here behind it. This is right next, this house stood right next to where the Aliquippa house is, which is near the mouth of the harbor. On that hill behind that house was the site of the fort, Fort Augusta. Now, long before there was Augusta, Maine, there was a fishing settlement called Augusta that they attempted to set up on Small Point Harbor. And who is this they? They being the Prejepskit proprietors. Now, around 1676, as you probably know, was the start of the Indian Wars around here. The settlers in the lower Kennebec and along the coast of Maine were burnt out, and for the course of 30 years after that, ongoing conflict resulted in people coming, people leaving, people coming, people leaving. Well, in the early 1700s, the Prejepskit proprietors were a company of Boston merchants that formed basically to buy a deed. Now, after the first Indian War had started, an English merchant named Richard Wharton began buying up deeds for the settlers who had been in this area and had gotten burnt out. And so the Wharton deed dates from the 1680s, and several different sagamores from the area signed part of that. But Wharton basically bought up deeds belonging to the early settlers and kind of consolidated them with the intent to develop this area. Well, he died before he was able to do anything with it. And the Prejepskit proprietors basically formed to buy out his estate, to buy these deeds, and to have a much more well-financed attempt to settle those lands. And those lands that they were attempting to settle ranged from Merrymeeting Bay down the Harpswell Peninsula and all the way down to Small Point. And in Small Point, they particularly were interested in a fishing operation. Oliver Noyes, one of the proprietors, this was kind of his pet project. Oliver Noyes, a rich Boston fish merchant, the creator of the Long Wharf in Boston, he resulted in that being built.
Well, Mr. Noyes believed to personally finance the building of a stone fort right on top of that hill there that guarded an operation believed to be involving around 25 boats were fishing out of Small Point Harbor around 1716, 1718. These were small fishing boats, just several crew members on them. A summer fishery, they would be fishing cod and drying them on the ledges around there. And that fort was built to both protect the fishery, but also to close the door that that carry represented into Casco Bay. Okay, this is a around a 1776 British map made of the same area. Again, here we have Popham over here, Atkins Bay. These are the salt marshes through here. And this is Hermit Island right here. This is Totman Cove and West Point over here. Noteworthy because you see a scattering of houses on the island, including one on the north end of the island, north end of Hermit Island. Yes, you bet. Right about there. Yep, and that's Goose Rock, and this is Sand Dollar Beach at the north end of Hermit Island. Bailey's Beach would be right about here. Lobster House Restaurant, right in there.
And what's the date again on this?
Yeah, this would be around 1716 is when they started the Augusta settlement. It lasted for about 4 to 6 years. The fort was built, but continuing Indian conflict resulted in it being abandoned. Now, let's see. All right, I'm gonna leave it there for a second so I can continue the story. Coming back to the carry, how do we know about the Indian carry and the original Indian people here? Well, it relates to the Prajepski proprietors. So in the process of them collecting deeds, one of the deeds that they purchased, collected, belonged to a woman named Rachel Atkins Drake. Now, Rachel was one of 10 daughters of Thomas Atkins. Thomas Atkins shows up on Atkins Bay over there in what we now know as Popham around the 1650s. Thomas Atkins came from the Plymouth Colony down in Massachusetts. You might know that the Plymouth Colony was actively involved in the fur trade on the Kennebec River and had fur trading posts up here, so had connections. So Mr. Atkins shows up in the 1650s and has 10 daughters, no sons. So I believe Atkins Farm, I believe, was right on the spot that later became known as Harbor Farm, and is where the Percy Cottages are now, down on Atkins Bay, and where that carry was. So basically, right about there. And so, very interesting, because they figured the deed, it was deeded in the early 1670s. So in the early 1670s, Rachel Atkins Drake, Drake because she married John Drake, a fisherman, they are believed to be the first European people to live on Small Point Harbor along that carry. Here she is coming from over here, ends up over there. But particularly noteworthy is that the land was deeded to Rachel, not her husband, John. That's noteworthy. The other noteworthy thing is that there were three different Indian people that deeded the land to her. You had Blind Joan, the Great Agamagus, and Sheepskit John. And so, what I'm going to tell you now, I got much of it from a very interesting article by Tad Baker, Emerson Baker, a archaeologist and historian who's been really deeply involved in researching early colonial Maine history. And so, the French knew the people in this area as the Almushiqua, and so he did some research on these people of this area known as the Almushiqua, and he was able to identify Joan in that deed as Waribada. That's her Wabanaki name, Waribada, and Waribada comes from Scarborough area. She was the daughter of a sachem of a leader over in the Scarborough area, Scarborough Marshes area on the western side of Casco Bay. And so that puts her on the other side of the bay. Now, Great Agumagus, it's not entirely clear who that refers to. It may refer to Mug or Mog, a leader from up the river. It is also uncannily close to Kankamangus. Kankamangus as a leader was associated, Kankamangus from the White Mountains was also associated and related to the Indian people that lived on the Androscoggin, in the upper Androscoggin there. So it's believed that the Great Agumagus is representing people from up the river. Blind Joan is representing the people that live on the bay. And Sheepskit John was the representative of the Midcoast people, most likely centered around the Sheepskit River, what became Wiscasset and stuff. And what that tells us that the point of land here in Small Point was a joint use area between three different Indian peoples, three different political entities. You had the Indian peoples living on the west side, their villages were on the west side of Casco Bay. So that would be Waribata, and Waribata's brother is another noted sagamore named Skidrigusit, or Skidrigusit, and he appears in the 1600s as well. He was believed or blamed for murdering a fur trader over on Richmond Island on the other side of the bay, but he had a village right near Portland, right at the mouth of the Presumpscot River there. There's a Skidrigusit Creek there. And so Joan was his sister. So a lot of times Native people would take on English names in contact with the English. So through deed research, we can connect Joan with Blind Joan with Waribata as one and the same person, most likely. So here we are in an area shared between those three tribes, between Indians in the upriver who would come down to the coast to get waterfowl, fish. The marshes themselves were an important source of basket materials. Sweetgrass grows in those marshes, which is used today by Wabanaki peoples for basketry. So I feel there had to have been a relationship of some sort between Joan and Rachel, that that female connection on both sides of that deed has some significance. The coastal people at that time had suffered enormous loss, the coastal native people. In the 1600s, at least several different mass die-offs essentially wiped out 90% of the coastal native population in the early 1600s. And so Joan represented a people, you know, that had been completely decimated by disease, that represented a tiny fraction of their original number and were already refugee communities, were the survivors of other communities that would come together. And so they oftentimes deeded Europeans land for what to us seems like nothing. But for Indian people, those deeds were like a relationship. So when you sold something to somebody, you weren't just selling a good that was then gone. It was you were entering into a reciprocal relationship. So trade was a way to bind people together. All right. All right, that's another map. Again, a clearer map. 1776, you just see a few houses around Lobster House Cove and a couple houses on Hermit Island. 1752 map. Again, the map's a little skewed. South is this way, north is that way, east, west. Pop them over here. Old Fort, that's representing the 1607 Old Fort. The marshes. Over here in Small Point Harbor, noteworthy because on the north end, we see a mill. We see up in the mouth of the harbor, fort, which is the fort that the Prejepskit proprietors built. And then on the island, we see McIntyre. and then another name down here, which could be Walker, could be Wallace. Probably more likely Wallace. But the fort was built. The fort was abandoned. There was bloodshed, much bloodshed. The carry was apparent to me when I found a letter from Captain Harmon. Captain Harmon in 1722 was stationed at the fort. He writes about firing on a flotilla of 50 canoes. And so that was the initial clue that led me to the existence of this carry, because why would 50 canoes be traveling right by a fort to be shot at down a dead-end harbor? Well, it's because it wasn't a dead-end harbor, it was actually a highway. It was an Indian highway, and they were traveling through there. So it was the some of the documents from the fort that led me to the existence of the carry through there. And it was the Prajepska proprietor's purchase of the deed from Rachel that basically, because the original deed was burnt up in Rachel's cabin when they were burnt out of there in 1676, the proprietors reconstructed the deed. And so that's how we know of the deed to from Blind Joan, Sheepskit John, and the great Agumagus to Rachel. And so that's kind of the connection between the proprietors and the fort and the carry. Now, after the abandonment of the fort and the Indian Wars in the 1720s, things were quiet in Small Point until about the 1750s. All right, I'm gonna stay on this picture for a while. And so this map is 1752. We see the McIntyres on what became Hermit Island. And so Joseph McIntyre is there by 1752, and his family builds a farm there and lives on the island up until about 1800. Joe McIntyre marries Sarah Wallace. And so we see the Wallace family down there, and the Wallace have been fishing in Small Point since at least the 1700s, probably the 1600s. And that's another interesting thing in the course of this research. It becomes apparent that Euro-American people have been fishing out of this harbor continuously for 200-300 years. And we have some of the same families that have been fishing since the 1700s are still fishing out of that area. The Wallaces being one of the oldest ones to be continuing that tradition. And that's pretty amazing when you see how much things have changed in this country in the last couple hundred years. Out of focus map made by the founder of one of the town fathers of Phippsburg, Mark Langdon Hill, made this map in the 1790s. This is Small Point Harbor. These hash marks indicate a grist mill. And that's the next part of my story here is, well, we're going to come back to this one, the mills. So we have a mill here. The other map indicated another mill. Something that's been happening in Small Point Harbor from the period of the 1700s up through the probably middle of the 1800s, at least through the early 1800s, was the existence of tide mills. Tide mills using the fall of the water to either saw lumber or to grind grain. And so we know in 1752 there is a tide mill on the north end of the island where the Hermit Island Lobster Pound is now. And I do not know at this point who was running that mill. I don't think it was the McIntyres. It might have been the Blevins at that point in time. But there was a mill there, and when our lobster pound was constructed in 1950, supposedly some of the timbers and stones and stuff were still there when our dam was constructed. Nathaniel Wyman also had a grist mill right across the harbor from Hermit Island. Old picture, this is the Aliquippa House on the left, and that's again that old house that I showed you where I was showing you the fort was. Both of those houses were constructed by the Lowell family, and the Lowells became prominent in Small Point in the late 1700s. Okay, this is the north end of Herman Island. This is the Herman Island Lobster Pound Dam, and that was also the site of that 1700s era tide mill. And that is looking down the cove of the Lobster Pound and would have been the mill pond in the late 1700s. That's low tide. Another more detailed map of the north end of the harbor. Right here is our Lobster Pound mill dam here. Now another, you can barely see it under the water there, but the remains of another dam that extended from the mainland out to this ledge here. This dam, noteworthy because this tidal mill, I do not believe, had a pond. This tidal mill operated with the actual flow of the tide back and forth through. And that, I believe, was the grist mill that Nathaniel Wyman had. Nathaniel Wyman died in 1789. The most valuable thing on his estate inventory was his grist mill. Interestingly, Nathaniel, so coming back over to Herman Island, the McIntyres and the Wymans are living there at the same time. They both show up. It's quite possible that the McIntyres and the Wymans were associated with the original Fort Augusta and that attempt at settlement, and then came back afterwards, because they're both believed to have shown up maybe around the 1730s or 1740s in the harbor. And so there's a lot of closeness between the families. When Joe McIntyre dies in 1776, none of his sons are old enough to inherit the land. Two of the sons go to live and come of age with Nathaniel Wyman, who would have been right across the harbor from them. And the youngest son, Henry, goes and is raised by Francis Wyman. So the McIntyre boys were raised by the Wyman family. But then later on, because of intermarriage, the Morses and the McIntyres were very much interconnected, which I'll get to here. Again, a low tide shot. You can see the tide mill dam right there, and then there's our Lobster Pound dam across from it. Another tide mill, this is the highway coming down, and there was another mill dam right across here that you can barely make out. This house right here is Merle Gillum's house, and Merle Gillum, the Gillum family are an old fishing family, and the Gillums, the Wallaces, and the Johnsons had a lease from the Morse family for this whole portion here of Herman Island from the mid-1800s up through the early 1900s. And you can actually look right across from Merle's house over to an old foundation right over here. It's a direct view. Merle's house lives in what was the Sylvester Store, which was the general store for Small Point in the late 1800s. All right, that's the Nathaniel Wyman Mill Dam, what's left of it. That is the Sylvester Store, Merle Gillum's house, and the remains of another dam. That's the pile of rocks across the middle there. This is a neat photo. My great-great-grandmother, Emma Sewell, took this photo. This is the Sylvester Store, what's now Merle's house, in the probably 1890s. Noteworthy in particular because of the fishing boat. The Lapstrake fishing boat, which is the type of small fishing boats that inshore fishermen used before the development of motors. This photo right here, now a bunch of these photos now are photos that my great-great-grandmother Emma Sewell took in the 1890s. They had a cottage on the other side of Small Point, her and her husband Arthur Sewell. So this is Head Beach, neat ash splint basket. Indian people made a lot of those baskets and still do. Another shot, this is either the east end of Head Beach or it might be the east end of Dune Beach on Herman Island. Again, 1890s. This is what we call Sand Dune Beach on Herman Island. This is part of the campground now. Some of the old postcards from around the turn of the century in that same area. I'm just going to skip over those. This is a neat photo. This is one that Emma took. You can still see this scene today. This is the upper branch of Small Point Harbor right behind the Herman Island store. And here they are digging clams and some rather huge clams. Again, probably 1890s. This right here, a modern picture of what we call on the campground Osprey Point, but what was known 100 years ago as Wallace Head and Wallace Head Cove. Let's see, 1908, George Graves published this postcard photo of Wallace Head Cove, and again, we call that Osprey Point now, and the cove we call the bathtub. Now, this is a photo, this is the same location. This is one of Emma's photos, and here are fishermen cleaning some fish in a dory in that cove. And I believe that's the same fisherman in the picture there. And there he is mending his net. And I do not know for sure, but I think that's Seth Wallace. And Seth lived in several locations on Hermit Island in the late 1800s and was also known to have lived on Wood Island, right off of Hermit Island. And that's, I believe, another photo of the same gentleman with a nice big lobster in his ash splint basket. And then either his wife and daughter, most likely. They all look like the same location. Now, where is this house? I'm not entirely sure, but it could very well be. This is a picture of the same location from looking at the top of the hill to Wallace Head Cove, what we now know as the bathtub. That's Gooseberry Island there. You can see a fish house there on the rocks. That's the only photo I know of that house. The photos of the doorstep, I suspect, might be the doorstep of that house. Now, that house wasn't there when our family purchased the land, and so I'm not sure what happened to that house. Now, this is really neat. This is an etching that Ernest Haskell did sometime around the turn of the century. The same location. So from the top of what we call Osprey Point or Wallace, looking down into Wallace Head Cove. And it's blurry because it came off of the internet from an auction site. It's the only copy I have. And actually, the person who found it, the image was reversed, so it wasn't exactly clear where it was. But I put it on the computer and was able to reverse it. And it, in fact, is a detailed etching of Wallace Head Cove, what we know now as the bathtub. And it's hard to make out, but you have fishing dories, fishermen on shore, and they're basically seining bait. There's a big net that they're closing in there and trapping bait and stuff, which is neat because they still catch bait right nearby there. Yeah, oh, now, so you're asking where, though, there's the photograph. There's a house there. There's the etching of the same location. There's no house there. So part of my future work is to try to figure out what year the etching was made. Well, that's Dune Beach. That's trees on Gooseberry Island and bald heads way down there. So it's part of the mystery of trying to time together who was where and when. But there are people standing where that house was. There are people right there. So they're looking for the house too, yeah. this right here, this is a diagram of a big fish pound that existed off of Small Point in the late 1800s. This is from a federal fisheries report. This is called a pound net, but basically a giant net corral that was used to trap fish. There were several of these around Hermit Island and Small Point, and they still use smaller versions of these fish pounds to catch bait fish today, and some of these same families that were fishing in this picture here are fish those bait pounds. You have Wallace's and Pies in that picture, from my understanding. And this is right off of Wood Island, off of Hermit Island, when they are tending one of those fish pounds. This was taken over on Hermit Island
Frank or Herbert Wallace, perhaps, we're not sure. Again, that's another photo that my great-great-grandmother took. Same individual, most likely on the north end of Hermit Island and one of the beaches there. And then when I'm feeling more ambitious, I should be able to figure out where that exactly is from the rocks, which don't change too much. But again, I think that's one of the beaches on the north end of Hermit Island. They're getting bait ready, I think, making bait. We're gonna skip that. This is another one. This is one of the fish shacks that were on the north end of the island. What's noteworthy here, we know, I know that the Wallaces were living on the north end near Sand Dollar Beach, Seth Wallace. This is really neat because look at the duck decoys, the carved duck decoys. Noteworthy because there are Wallace family members that still continue that tradition in Phippsburg today, carving those duck decoys and hunting. Another poorly focused one, but again, turn of the century, this is Bald Head in the very south end of Small Point. You see some fish houses there on Bald Head Cove that are no longer there, and some dories. That is most likely where Samuel Wallace lived in the mid-1700s. Samuel's daughter, Sarah, married Joe McIntyre. And so Hermit Island was originally known as McIntyre's Neck. And Joe's head would be Joseph McIntyre. Joe's head being the southern tip of Hermit Island. This is off of Head Beach, again, around the turn of the century. There's a schooner. Whoop. Another one of the pound nets in Small Point. This, I believe, is on Head Beach. I think this is one of the trails off of Head Beach onto Hermit Island. This was labeled the Road to Johnson's Pound. Now, I told you back in the mid-1800s, there were three fishing families that rented land from the Morses. You had the Gillams, the Wallaces, and the Johnsons. Abner Johnson got his start on Hermit Island in fishing in Small Point Harbor and would later become, by the late 1800s, a fairly well-to-do fish merchant and major player in the fishing industry in Casco Bay. And he got started here at Hermit Island. This is John Eason. You might have seen this picture before. He was one of the Malaga Island people that was eventually evicted off of Malaga Island. Well, John came from Ashdale, in the Ashdale, the portion of Phippsburg. And what's interesting is that is where John Morse had the original mill of the Morse family. It was in Ashdale. Well, Mr. Eason came from Ashdale. And he shows up on a census over in Hermit Island in about the mid-1800s. So before he ended up in Malaga Island, he was down in the Small Point area. And I see a Morse connection between Ashdale and Hermit Island. Now, how did we go from McIntyre's Neck to Morse's Neck? Because Hermit Island was also known as Morse's Neck. And that's because the oldest daughter of Joseph McIntyre, Mehetable married David Morse, and when Joe McIntyre died, Mehetable and David took over the family farm on Hermit Island. And they would live there, and they took care of the mother-in-law, Sarah. She died at the end of the Revolution, American Revolution. And David Morse and Mehetable would live on the farm up to the early 1800s, at which point they moved to Leeds, Maine. And most likely what happened is, by 1800, you had already had 50 years of continuous farming on the north end of Hermit Island on not particularly good land. The farm was pretty used up at that point, and David and Mehetable headed inland to Maine, where there was a lot better farmland. And so for the next several decades, it's not entirely clear who's living on the island. It's Morse's. I have records of the original John Morse buying up interests of his relatives on Hermit Island, but by the mid-1800s, Winslow Morse owned the whole island and was living on the farm on the north end of the island. And Winslow had two sons, William and Albert, and the
farm was first passed to William. William was a city man. He ended up in the Boston area. And so he acquired the island in, I think, 1872 from his father, Winslow. Several years later, he deeded it to his younger brother, Albert. Albert Morse became the hermit of Hermit Island that it was named after. Albert never married. He was the last Morse family member to live on the family farm there, and he died in the early 1900s. The oral history I've heard was that the fishermen were wondering, hadn't seen him for a while, and somebody decided to go check on him and went up to the house, and they found him dead. And so I just recently found out Albert wasn't always a hermit, because on one of the censuses, in the 1880 census, he's still taking care of his mother, Lydia. Lydia Morse, Winslow Morse's wife. So he only became a hermit, apparently, after his mother passed on. Mouth of the harbor, noteworthy because of these fishing boats here. These are pre-motorized fishing boats. These are a type of boat known as a Hampton boat. These were the predecessor to the modern Maine lobster boat. These are neat because this is what they looked like before they were motorized. This is taken from about where the Aliquippa house is. This is all Hermit Island here. And you can just barely make out on the top of the hill there a house. That was the original McIntyre homestead there, what became the Morse farm on the north end of Hermit Island. Now, those boats are neat. Here's lines from the Smithsonian from a ship model that was donated in 1879 to the Smithsonian by Captain Charles Henry McIntyre. That boat was built at the Sylvester store that I showed you a picture of earlier, right there on Small Point Harbor. That is your quintessential classic lobster boat before there were motors in the latter half of the 1800s. That boat was reconstructed by the apprentice shop here in the either 70s or 80s. And that boat now is in the possession of the Chowanke Foundation, who I believe have restored it. But it's really neat because that boat was built on Small Point Harbor originally, and Captain Charles Henry McIntyre is a descendant of Joseph McIntyre, who had the farm there on Hermit Island. That's about a 20 foot by 8 feet or so. It's pretty beamy, heavy, two-masted rowing and sailing boat. And I mention it because that boat right there looks an awful lot like that boat right there, and that may in fact be the same boat. Another photo, late 1800s. I know we're dragging on here, I tend to do that. Again, looking over to Hermit Island, a better shot of the McIntyre than the Morse house. Center chimney cape, 18 feet by 36 feet. It had an unattached barn. Now, this is a neat little house right across. This is on Hermit Island. This is where I believe Seth Wallace eventually ended up with his family, right there. And I think that earlier picture with the duck decoys might have been one of these sheds. But also it shows the size of the schooners that would originally come into Small Point Harbor. Now, the Lowells, who I mentioned, they had numerous business interests, but one of the things they were doing for a while was cutting ice. And they would cut ice from an ice pond over by the Sylvester store, and they had a sluice that would bring it over to the Aliquippa. And probably the ice industry had ended by this point, judging from the state of the wharf, but would have been brought across the wharf and loaded on schooners there. A slightly later picture, believed to be around maybe the 20s. That was one of the ferry boats that served the resort industry on Casco Bay, and that would stop at the Aliquippa House and went up and down the New Meadows. You can see the same cottage now has dormers built onto it. My understanding is the remains of that cottage were torn down by my grandfather when he got the property in 1950. Some more old photos. That's Weber Island in Small Point Harbor. Weber Island was a retreat of the artist John Marin, in the early 1900s, who painted a bunch of paintings down there. There's the Aliquippa House. What's interesting about the Aliquippa is, built in 1836, was a guest house from the earliest days. So Small Point has had a tourism industry since the earliest days of tourism in Maine, from the, you know, at least the mid-1800s. Ah, yes. These are some of Mr. Marin's paintings painted down in Small Point in the early 1900s. I'm sure you know where exactly that is. just to give you an idea, this one is actually the mouth of Small Point Harbor. That's Wood Island out there, Bailey's Beach off to the right, and Goose Rock to the left, if you use your imagination. Another one, perhaps another better one of the mouth, Topman Cove at the top, Bailey's Beach, Goose Rock, but 1928 he painted that one. All right, this is a really neat one. I found, somebody turned me on to this postcard. This is an actual mailed postcard, and the text around the edge is great. This picture was taken over on the mainland near the Manly Cottage. It shows our place in the distance, Morse's Neck, the house and barn where the crosses are. Now, this postcard was either sent by or to Alice Morse. What they call the Manly Cottage is what's called now the Percy House. It was actually the Abner Lowell House. It's right on the road going down to Hermit Island. This is Lobster House Cove here. And you're looking kind of north-northwest across the cove in Small Point Harbor to Hermit Island. And the two X's they're talking about, you've got the house and the barn on the top of the hill there. And again, that farm was started in around 1750 or so, and all that remains now are the foundation and the pasture and the walls and stuff of that. But it was classic English barn, not attached to the house in the 1700s. You didn't have your attached barns yet. But that's, again, one of the few images that show the farm on the north end, the original McIntyre and later the Morse farm. Now this photo taken at the same time from the exact opposite. This is from the top of Hermit Hill on Hermit Island, looking southeast across the harbor, Lobster House Cove, and then the ocean in Seguin's off of that way. So that previous picture that I told you about was taken from the backyard of either this house here or right over here, looking across. But this was the original farm pasture of the McIntyre farm going down to the harbor. It doesn't look like that now because when the campground was built, we excavated part of this hill for fill to create the campground. So when you drive down Hermit Island now, you get to the north end, there's a gravel pit there. Well, that gravel pit used to be hillside, and the original farmstead is above the gravel pit. Now that's the top of the hill now. That's taken from where the barn was, looking south. That's the foundation of the house itself, the McIntyre House. I'm going to wind back now. So the McIntyres, the Morses, coming back to the original native history. We tend to think of Indian people here in this state. We think of the Indian Wars, and then in this area, they kind of disappear from our history and our thoughts. And for Indian people, the ties to the land are very long and very deep. And so apparent to me that Indian people continue to this day come to use these areas and still occupy and find importance in these places. One of the things I mentioned earlier was sweetgrass. Sweetgrass still grows in the marshes of Small Point and Popham, and Native people still travel from the other parts of the state where they still live to come and get sweetgrass down there in Phippsburg. And we think of there are no more Kennebec Indians, but it's important to remember the Indian people that lived here at the mouth of the Kennebec and farther up the river. Their descendants, in the course of the Indian Wars, they were driven from those lands, but their descendants ended up in both Quebec and in Penobscot land in the
eastern part of the state. So amongst the Penobscot people here today, there are descendants of people that lived over this way. And so through the 1800s, Indian people, to survive, they would travel down the coast, and they adapted to the tourism economy, and they continued traditional crafts like basket making and such, and they would travel to the new tourism areas, and they would sell their wares. And so, I know these are hard to see. These are photos probably from the 1920s from Small Point. I believe that is Frank Ledeman up there, who worked for the Dearborns, who have a large cottage in Small Point. And these are Native people, Native children, a Native guy, and the name on the old photo, I want to say it was either Sebattis or not Sockalexis, but it's a common Native name. And so these folks would travel, and they came in the 1920s, and there were Indian people coming all the way to the 1970s to Small Point in the summertime to sell basketry and do storytell. And so I still have memories as late as the 1970s, maybe early 80s, there was an Indian couple that would come to Hermit Island and set up at the campground and sell jewelry and storytell in my lifetime. I suspect they're relatives to these people from these 1920s pictures. One of the things they would do is they would let people dress up in their regalia and take pictures as well. So you're going to see some pictures of white people dressed up in regalia. Again, these all were photos taken around the Dearborn Cottage. And there are people, summer residents down at Small Point, that still have baskets, sweetgrass baskets and stuff that were bought from these folks in the early 1900s. And so a future exhibit at the Phippsburg Historical Society will be the continuing Native presence in Phippsburg through the 20th century. And again, that's a picture out on the beach of one of the Indian kids. And these are folks dressing up in Indian garb at that same time, getting their pictures taken. And then finally, we're gonna wrap it up here. 1940s. Hermit Island and Head Beach was the location of a commercial seaweed operation. A company called Marine Growth Incorporated had an Irish moss operation, collection, sorting, cleaning, right there on Head Beach. And so this is a 1943 news article, a picture of a guy cutting it with a long rake, some folks sorting it. This was Irish moss. And then this picture, I know it's hard to see, but again, this is right on Head Beach, looking down the harbor where we saw those guys clamming earlier. Same location. That's a big pile of Irish moss there. Now, Irish moss was a source of agar, food additive, still very important. Here is a photo of the actual operation on Head Beach. In the 1940s. What's noteworthy is there's no dunes on the beach. The whole beach was bulldozed flat. White canvases were laid out with wooden boardwalks between them. And so the moss was dried out on the canvas, keep it from getting all sandy. And it looks like they'd cover it up too, from keep it from getting rained on and stuff. And then, so this is Hermit Island back over here. This building right here, that's the kelp shed. And our main recreation building on the island at the entrance is the kelp shed, and it is the remains of this historic seaweed operation. There's also another blue cottage over on the beach that has grown larger over the years, and from my understanding, that shed is somewhere inside of it or part of it to this day, that this grew to become that cottage. So we share the beach. The Wymans and the Sewells share Head Beach. And so this coming year, I would invite you to the Historical Society Museum in Phippsburg, because over the winter, Linda Wyman and myself will be working on an exhibit about this historic seaweed operation. And I would like to connect it to the current and ongoing growth of the seaweed industry in Maine, both edible seaweed and industrial seaweed, which is happening. So there's some historic connection between modern seaweed and not so long ago seaweed operation. Big fire burned in the 1930s, burnt down much of the island. The only portion of Harmon Island that didn't burn is the very north end, so you can find some of the bigger trees up at the north end. This picture is taken from Lobster House Cove, looking across to Harmon Island. This right here, 1950, this is the construction of the Harmon Island Lobster Pound. There's big old barge there. Going to be building a dam across there where the historic mill was. It's also a neat picture because you can see these openings here. This pasture, that was all the original McIntyre and Morse farm. And so there's apple trees through here. And again, the house and the barn were right up at the top of the hill here. And here we are again. I think that's where we started. Oh yeah, that's one more. Okay, one more last kind of aerial photo of the whole island. Again, you can see the farm, where the farm was, and the pasture there on the north end. And one last thing. This picture right here, this was a source of great controversy in the early 1960s in Phippsburg. This was a publicity stunt that was done by the state government of Maine to commemorate what the state was considering the real first Thanksgiving at the Popham Colony. And so this appeared in papers around, and to the outrage of the people in Popham, who were quick to point out that that is not Popham. All right, well, I know where this is. That's on Hermit Island. And that's Gooseberry Island right there. So this was done on Hermit Island. I suspect my grandfather's connections with people in state government resulted in them choosing Hermit Island as the location for their publicity stunt. Those are, in fact, Native people from Maine. Those are Maine Native people that were part of that. But in the process of my research and now being a member, trustee of the Historical Society, I come to find out that it was a major controversy at the time, and the people of Popham were greatly offended that this publicity photo was not done on site. And so I think, oh yeah, one more thing. All right, this is the real last thing. You will find this anchor at the entrance when you drive up onto Hermit Island. It's a giant metal anchor, and people always ask, where did that anchor come from? Well, that brings us back to the beginning of the story and my family ending up here in Bath, and we had a shipyard here on Front Street for almost 100 years, from 1820, 22 till the early 1900s. And that metal anchor presumably was left over from the shipyard and ended up down on Hermit Island as a symbol icon of our campground. So I've left out a bunch. This perhaps wasn't the most coherent presentation, but look for the book in the future.